Well, we have with us Mr. Sajjan Jindal, the Vice Chairman and Managing Director of JSW Steel, to talk about the numbers. Thank you very much, Mr. Jindal, to talk to Bloomberg TV India. It's a pleasure to have you. To start with, what has led to the fall in your consolidated profit by almost 60%? Can you just specifically talk about the issues that the company has seen this quarter, this fiscal actually, and this quarter in particular?
Well, last year our consolidated numbers and this year's consolidated numbers are up, I think, 79-80%. So therefore, I think we are quite satisfied with our performance, the company. I mean, and given on the with the background that we had lack of raw materials to operate our plants. We operated the plant at 80% capacity. We invested a lot of money in expansion of the plants, which got completed last year. So therefore, these were quite challenging times for us. But I think thanks to the team that we have, the organization that we have, we were able to really make the best out of the situation. Now about the consolidated numbers, you see we have large investments overseas, whether in the US or iron ore mining in Chile, coal mines in US. So our investments overseas have not been very, very good. And also we have JSW Ispat, which is also now kind of turning around, but last year that also made a loss. So we have a very large portfolio of subsidiary companies and overseas investments. So they have been struggling over the last year, which now are looking much better. So therefore, we expect that the future is going to be much better than the past.
Sure, the future will be better than the past. But the mining ban, which was the highlight and really talk of the town all of last year, with A and B mines now opening up, what are your expectations and hopeful that C will also open up soon? How do you see that turning around your operations? And can you quantify that for us? Because you've said that if this happens, there will be an improvement, a great improvement in your profitability overall. So can you quantify if this happens, how will JSW Steel benefit?
So if I were to give you a big picture, the Supreme Court has capped the total production of iron ore in Karnataka at 30 million tons. Till last year, only about 6-7 million tons of fresh production was happening. And rest of it was either coming from outside the state or was being using the old and low-grade iron ore which is lying in the mines, which were lying in the mines, was being auctioned. So we at JSW Steel require about 20 million tons of iron ore. Out of the 30 million total cap which the Supreme Court has put, 20 million is our own requirement. And with the low production, we were buying material. We were bringing material from Orissa, from Jharkhand, from Chhattisgarh, and so also imported material. So therefore, we somehow struggled through the process, through the time, and we operated the plant at 80% capacity. Now the situation is improving. The NMDC itself is producing 10 million tons. A category mines, which have already opened up, is producing 5 million tons. B category, a couple of mines have opened up, which is producing 1 million ton. And over the next 4-5 months, we hope that other B category mines will also open up and add up another 5 million tons. So therefore, there would be about 20-21 million tons of fresh production of iron ore which will come in. And still there are about 8-9 million tons, 10 million tons of low-grade dumps which are lying in Karnataka, which we hope to use through innovative methods and through beneficiation plants, and we will use it. So therefore, we think that in next, once the B category mines also open up, till the C category really gets auctioned and material, fresh material comes, we would be able to survive one more year.
All right. And also, your expansion plans, you had very categorically spoken about how you're not going ahead with a 2 million expansion plan at Vijayanagar. The West Bengal project was also stalled. When do you see that turning around? Do you think you can give a timeline as to when you can restart and start the expansion on these two projects?
Yeah. You will appreciate that, steel industry is very, very much dependent on availability of iron ore. So you can't make steel without iron ore. And today the Government of India policies are very clear that iron ore can freely move between the states or there should not be any restriction. But what we are really observing is that the iron ore is not freely moving, and there's a lot of restrictions, a lot of constraints that have come in because people have misutilized or misused the approval process and all, and a lot of illegal mining happened and stuff like that. So therefore, the way forward for us is that unless and until we have a clarity on the iron ore policy, and unless we see that the Bengal project will get iron ore from neighboring states, because Bengal doesn't have iron ore, unless that happens, we will not be able to take that project forward. So therefore, right now that project is sort of on hold, so to say, but we are very advanced discussions with the government of India and with the help of government of West Bengal, which is also working with us to talk to government of India to get us some linkage, long-term linkage for our Bengal project.
Not at least for the next 1 year?
I don't know. It could, if somebody really wakes up to the idea that...
But realistically?
I don't know. Yeah, I don't think so. Yeah.
Right. Acquiring assets, you were talking and referring to the fact that, you need captive mines, both domestically and internationally. What's your strategy going to be? Are you on a lookout of mines, and have you identified certain geographies, etc., where you would be putting your money in?
As of today, we are at 14 million ton capacity, which means that we need about 25 to 30 million tons of iron ore, depending on what grade of iron ore we are using. We are a very large iron ore consumer. So therefore, for us to be fully integrated, this part of integration has not happened. Yeah. Rest of it, we have fully integrated. So to integrate us fully, we are looking very aggressively domestically as well as globally to acquire some iron ore assets.
Yeah, that's exactly what I said. But can you give us some sense on what geographies are you looking at?
Have
you identified? Would it be in the next 6 months, 1 year? Can you give us a timeline?
It's very difficult to really identify or really understand about that. But we have identified geographies are Australia, West Africa, Brazil, Canada. These are the four real geographies where iron ore is in plenty. But these are not easy geographies, and our experience with international investment has not been very good. So we want to be very, very careful for investing even 1 rupee. We want to be sure that this would be a really worthwhile investment.
Last question in terms of the guidance that you have set out for the steel industry and for JSW steel particularly. Now, you're expecting that you would grow by 9 to 10% next quarter, next fiscal.
Year. Mm-hmm.
So what gives you that confidence, and can you just take us through the pricing scenario as well? Steel price.
No, as far as we have given guidance on the production, and so therefore, because of the opening up of these mines, we believe that we will be able to up our production levels by 5 to 10% capacity levels because of the availability of the iron ore. With regard to your other question about markets and demand scenario and all, I believe that there is enough demand in India, and we'll be able to. I don't see any issue about selling the products.
And how is the pricing going to be largely?
So pricing is all determined by the international prices. So whatever the international prices, basically calculated backward, becomes the domestic price. So therefore, that's the sort of the benchmark pricing, and whatever is the international price, we follow that number.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Jindal. It's a pleasure to have you.
Thank you.
Thanks so much.